After the events in my growing up series, and as much as I really wanted out of Ohio, I went ahead and stayed in Ohio. Living with my grandparents, and job hopping in an attempt to find something I was good at, and something that I could find a career doing. Finally, I found a job that I loved, but it didn't pay any more than the bills I had, and to keep gas in my car and money for cheap beer and cheap liquor that I bought with my fake ID for the parties that my now graduated church friends had every week. That may not be entirely accurate, because I do remember a rather extensive music and movie collection, but it kind of seemed that way at the time. During the quick stint at ORU, I'd racked up quite a few credit card bills because I was finally able to get credit cards, and I thought that I'd have a job the second semester and I would calm down on the frivolous spending. Add to that, the school loans for that one semester I was enrolled weren't petty. I had had a personal finance class in high school, but the importance of being smart about money wasn't pressed hard enough to get through my thick skull,
and I actually still have some debt from that time period due to poor money management over the years. Nothing like a crappy credit rating to remind you of a crappy past.
But reading through old saved ICQ conversations, which is about all I have because the journal entries for that time period are non-existent, I can see myself slowly turning into a monster, for lack of a better term. The empathy I had as a younger teenager for others and their cares and concerns was slowly being pushed down and away as I started to experience some more of the dark side of life. Never one to have a lot of close friends, the betrayal and trust by one exceptionally good friend led me to adopt a me versus everyone mentality, and the peninsula I had been living on for many years prior turned into an island as the waves of suspicion, distrust, jealousy, and personal interest washed away the path I took to get where I was. Now, I do realize that life and the experiences of life are how we learn what emotions are and how they work, and that trial and error are the best teachers we have. But I still have to wonder why my idea of love turned into something so jaded and misunderstood. My mom had always warned me about the fine line between love and lust, but her motivation was to continue the abstinence message she believed in. So I never understood what love was beyond the definitions laid out in the Bible verses I had read. And while 1 Corinthians 13 actually does a good job defining love, I was lost when it came to actually experiencing and understanding love in a non-Christian atmosphere. I know that most people never have a sit-down with their parents for a lesson in what love is and how to have a healthy relationship with members of the opposite sex or the same sex, but when you live in such a sheltered environment such as my entire childhood, there really needs to be an understanding by the parents that their kids aren't always going to keep on sheltering themselves, and that they need to be more prepared than the parents just saying, "Seek God first," and moving 4 states away. My parents, after I graduated high school, and under the impression that I'd be in Tulsa at ORU for the next 4 years or so, took an assignment in Washington, D.C., so their direct influence on my day-to-day life ended pretty much right after I graduated. But the lessons that I never learned? I was on my own to figure it out, and even now I feel there are many things I still don't fully understand, and many of my actions in regards to things such as relationships are actually harmful to fulfilling my desire to find a girl to love and be loved by for longer than a year or so before it turning to shit, and then spending another 2 years too chicken shit to walk away from. Regardless of my desire to understand love now, when I was 19, I started dating a girl that would be integral in many of the choices I would make and the reasons behind some of the wounds I suffered over the next few years. I, of course, mistook lust for love again, and while I would eventually learn how to love at least a bit, I was more interested in her warm, moist places than I was in her heart or her mind. I have very little from the beginnings of our relationship to jog my memory, but I do remember the relationship blossoming and spending endless nights either in an empty parking lot talking, or on the computer talking to her online, and I remember that once we became physically intimate, it was as if the floodgates opened up and we were just like a couple of rabbits. The guilt I had 2 years earlier when I first started having sex was still with me, but whenever I felt guilty, I just got more angry at God and my parents for making me hate myself for being human. Not all of my hatred was reserved for a God I felt let me down, let me fail, and let me suffer. Trust me, there was more than enough to spread around. And while I tended to treat others with the respect I wanted for myself, I spent many nights locked in a state of fatalistic dread, where I felt my only option to exercise my free will was to kill myself. And there were many lonely nights where I wondered if the rafters in my grandparents' basement would break from the weight of my limp and lifeless body. You see, there was a world out there. There was a life to live. And while it may be true that the only way to learn is to attempt to live, I wasn't prepared, and the actions and the mindset and my past guided me into a battle zone that quickly turned into even more of a me versus them situation where I felt, because I was told that I was special, I was chosen, I was a son of God, I felt that I was at the top of the food chain, and anyone that disagreed with me was a lower class human that couldn't understand my perfection and was thus dispensable. It started slowly. Things like manipulating conversations to confuse and confound so that others were left with no arguments against my points. But it quickly turned to outright derision for others, including those I claimed to care about. Now I can sit here and blame all of my issues as a 20-year-old on being raised in a sheltered, overly protective, highly dogmatic, and emotionally stunting environment. But the truth is, that blame can only go so far before I'm forced to accept that while I may have exited the gate late and with a bit of a limp, once I learned the game and had the chance to play fairly, I'm the one that chose to be a dastardly and vicious bastard. After 2 more years of off and on with the girl I mentioned before, she and I moved to Tulsa, where I thought I would stop off for a few years on my way to Hollywood to become a screenwriter. While we weren't officially together, the nights spent in each other's beds pretty much negated my objections when people asked me about my girlfriend. And what she saw in me, I'm still not sure, because I remember a fair amount of that first year back in Tulsa. I was filling up with anger and I had to let it out at least a bit to keep from exploding. And she was directly in the path. History means nothing. It is only a guide to what we have done in the past. What has worked, what hasn't worked. Who we shouldn't have trusted, killed, conquered, or elected. Who we should have trusted, killed, conquered, or elected. And what we need to change to become better people. History is our owner's guide to the world. How much pollution can we take? How much war can we take? How much food do we need to survive? What we need to do to fix something once we break it, etc. The past is written in stone. It cannot be changed, and why try? Those who forget about the past are doomed to repeat it at one time or another. As to where it's headed, it's not going anywhere. History can't outrun the present just as the present can't outrun the future. That was my answer as a naive and broken 17-year-old to the question, what is the meaning and direction of history? Being rather narrow-sighted and narrow-minded at that age led me to believe that while history may have been important at one time, the human race had learned the lessons of history and we were on the right track. I didn't apply that question to my own history at the time because I was in automatic mode at that point. I knew I only had 1 more year until freedom, 1 more year until I wasn't being forced to live my life the way my parents wanted me to live it, and the only motivation I had to answer that question was to get through another day of school so I could just get the hell home and watch some more TV. Looking at that question now and applying it to the history of my own life, I'm slightly stumped, to be honest. What is the meaning of my history? Is it just a story to define how I got where I am, both physically and mentally, or emotionally? Does it hold clues to who I am and why I can't answer that question? Or is it actually a guide? Do I look at my past, my history, and spend all of my time saying, what if, or if only, or I should have? Unfortunately, I do that. I was once accused of mourning my past and not being able to rise above the shit to see that I am actually okay and worthy of all that life has to offer. I tend to wallow in self-pity and think that my brand of suffering gives me the right to be broken and not try and fix anything about myself. Working through these videos, I see that much of my past is cyclical. I not only failed to learn, I willingly walked into the same situation time and time again, hoping for a different outcome. So what is the direction of history? What's the direction of my history? Understanding and application of the lessons learned. In 15 years, I don't plan on sitting here and writing about going from this point in my life here in 2011 and repeating the 15 years I'm writing about now. Semantics aside, history does actually have a direction, but as the Greeks said, it is laid out in front of us, as the future comes from behind. Life is lived by walking in reverse, and while closing one's eyes to the past laid out before them can be harmful, sometimes it's necessary if we want to remember that we are here, now, instead of obsessing on and mourning our pasts. I'm trying to gain whatever knowledge I can from my past so that I can close the book on it and move on not only to a new chapter, but to a new volume of life that takes the lessons of my history, but leaves the baggage behind, which is exactly where it belongs.